Hello, everybody. I'm pleased to welcome you to our webinar, High Precision Directional Surveying in Tunneling, Mining and Shipbuilding. Our today's presenter is Volker Schirper, Senior Geophysicist and responsible for business development in directional surveying at DMT Group. He is accompanied by Jörg Niese, Electrical Engineer and Development Director of the Gyromet System. My name is Knut Hirsch, and I'm your moderator today. And within the setup, we hope to answer almost every question that comes up. In this webinar, Volker will introduce the gyroscope principle, the Gyromet system, and applications in tunneling, mining, and shipbuilding. This shows how you can carry out your directional surveying project with highest accuracy and efficiency. Before we start, a few words about organizational issues of this webinar. You are invited to ask questions. For organizational reasons, I will collect them via the chat and ask these questions on your behalf to the expert at the end of the webinar. If you would like us to contact you after the webinar, please post it in the chat. Only we can see your entries and we get back to you at short notice. However, after the webinar, you will get the presentation via email. And that's it almost. Just one more thing, last but not least, this webinar will be recorded while preserving your anonymity. So that's it. Thank you so far, Volker. The digital floor is yours.
Okay. Thank you, Knut, for the introduction. Good morning and welcome to the webinar about Gyromet 5000. Thank you for joining. As Knut said, I will start with a presentation, which takes about 30 minutes. And after that, we have time to discuss or to answer questions. Oops, sorry. So the presentation is divided into four chapters. I start with the introduction of Gyromet 5000. After this, the application for Gyromet, the high accuracy tunnel survey. Following is the metrology application for Gyromet. And in the end, I give some examples and case studies. The principle of gyroscope is written down or is in the German standard of industry. A gyroscope is a pendulous suspended electronic driven gyro, which spin vector is influenced by gravity and Earth rotation. It will direct it to astronomic north. Here on the right side, you will see the gyro mass, which is rotating around this gyro axis. It is hanging on a suspension tape, and when the gyro is rotating, this axis tries to get in parallel to the Earth rotation axis. Around this measuring cell, we build our instrument, our Gyromet 5000. Gyromet 5000 has the highest accuracy in the world. It's about 0.8 milligon, which is 1.2 centimeter per kilometer, or 0.76 inch per mile. We have a relative short measuring time. It's 6 to 9 minutes. The weight for the total station, the weight for the gyromet without total station is 11.5 kilogram. It's fully automatic. It's pre-orientation free, and we can equip our gyromet with different kind of Leica total station, where the accuracy has to be at least 1 second. In DMT, we have a long history for developing of gyro systems. Here you see a picture from 1955. With a Meridianweiser MW3. This instrument had a weight of 400 kilogram, a measuring time of 3 hours, and an accuracy of 7 millicon. Between this time and today, we had made a lot of developments. You see different stages, 1955, 1959, 1963, and so on. And today, we have the Gyromet 5000, with an accuracy of 0.8 milligon. We have the Gyromet 3000 with 1 milligon accuracy. and the MW3000, which is an explosion-proof gyro, which can be used in a coal mine or in other industry with explosion hazard atmosphere with an accuracy of 2 milligon. The general assembly of the gyromat looks like this. We have the gyromat itself with this measuring cell. We have the Leica total station and the data communication cable. You put everything together. And so the gyromat can communicate with the total station, and via these five buttons, we can operate the whole system. The adapter ring, which is changeable, will be used for the leveling of the system. We have it's driven by a battery, or the power supply is done by a battery, which can be charged in the charging unit, charging adapter and charging unit outside the gyromat. And then this battery can be inserted into the gyromat. Changing of batteries in the construction site or where you have your measurement is possible, so you can extend the measuring time with some batteries in spare. Also possible to charge the battery inside the gyromat. Remote control via laptop or PC is possible, either via data cable or wireless. And so that the data can be transferred wireless or with data cable to a device, or the system can be operated remote controlled. The standard delivery includes a gyromat 5000, charging unit, a battery, data cable, manual, screwdriver, transport container, mechanical clamp, and a tripod. You put all the things into the transport box. Yeah. For accessories, we have the charging adapter, a carrying support, an optical centering system, and a pillar adapter. How to build up or install the system? In the first slide, I show you how we make it with a standard mechanical plump. So we have the gyromat, put it with the adapter ring on the tripod, and with a mechanical plump, we get the position of the tripod or the gyromat. And then the survey can be done. Instead of the mechanical plump, we can use the optical centering system. For this, we put the adapter ring on the tripod and the optical plummet into the adapter ring. With this, we do the optical centering positioning. After this, the optical centering system will be replaced by the gyromat. Especially in tunnels where a lot of wind destroy or makes it very uncomfortable to work with a mechanical plump, the optical centering system is a good alternative. Another option for installation is using a wall bracket. And with a wall bracket, we install our pillar adapter on the tripod, on this wall bracket, and on this the gyromat. You see on the right side in the tunnel, the wall bracket, tri-bridge, pillar adapter, and gyromat. For the application for gyromat, I will go on with a high accuracy tunnel survey. The first question is about the accuracy for the tunnel position. So the accuracy depends on some factors. One of them is the tunneling method, like if they use the TBM for tunneling or blasting. So the requirement on accuracy is different. Also, a different requirement on accuracy comes from the construction condition, like length of tunnel, diameter of tunnel, the direction if it is curved or more straight. And also another point is the use of the tunnel in operation. For different users, we have different requirements on accuracy. examples for challenging requirements and accuracy. One example is a predefined demounting construction, as you see in the picture. This kind of demounting constructions often has to very limited variance for the TBM, so that sometimes only a few centimeters, the accuracy has to be only a few centimeters. Another challenge for high requirement of accuracy is a high-speed railway tunnel. There, the alignment accuracy at each tunnel position has to be very accurate, also about some centimeters. Or if the tunnel will be tunneled from both sides, from two sides, and the two tunnels meet in the middle, in the cut-through position, we also have a requirement of a high accuracy. And how to achieve a high accuracy? First, you use an advanced guidance navigation system. But these guidance navigation systems needs high precision tunnel coordinates. And how to get the tunnel coordinates? Normally, there's an establishment of an efficient survey system with surface network, and the direction will be transferred via traverse lines into the tunnel. But how precise is the correct tunnel direction? So the survey system includes a surface network, which is created by GNS, or sometimes they use local surface networks. And the direction of the surface network will be transferred into the tunnel via open traverse line. And this makes some problems. So we transfer the direction from the starting point, which is linked to the surface network, over several survey points to the end of the tunnel. These survey points have distances between 50 meter or more than 200, depending on the tunnel, depending on the sides, on the view, free view in a tunnel. Every survey from one point to another incorporates an error, which leads to a deviation, and this error propagates to the next survey point. Deviation increases with tunnel lengths. So deviations are unavoidable. In particular, we have, I list three main reasons for errors. Is error propagation, plumbing error when starting a tunnel from a shaft, or refraction error. All these three will lead into a lateral deviation, and the Gyromat 3000 or the Gyromat 5000 can help to avoid or reduce these errors. Let's have a look to the error propagation. Here in this drawing, we have the survey points and the traverse line. And for, as said, each traverse line incorporates some errors. And in the end, after a while, you get error in direction. The Gyromat do not use the traverse line. It just measures the direction referred to astronomic north. So that means we get a gyro surveyed polygon site where the direction is independent from the measuring before. So we use these directions to make a correction to the traverse line. After this, the tunneling continues, and the error propagates. And after a while, we have a bigger error, which we reduce or which we correct by a survey with Gyromat. The plumbing error, it's illustrated here. We have a shaft, and we have the direction or the survey surface network on the surface, and have to put the direction into the shaft, into the level of the tunnel by plumbing. So we have two points. This is the result for plumbing, and we have the baseline. But this baseline is mostly very short because of the size of the shaft. So the theoretical direction of the tunnel is this direction, but in reality, when we have a small arrow in this very short baseline, we get in the end a higher error. With Gyromat, we just need one of the points, so we do not need the direction, we just need one point. And the direction comes from the internal north direction, which is measured by the Gyromat. And so we can just correct the direction of the whole polygon. Another point to consider is the refraction and tunnel. So we have in the beginning, we have the baseline or the starting direction, and we calculate or we think about straight beams. But in reality, especially if there are high temperature changes between tunnel wall and center of tunnel, the curves are not, the beam is not straight, it's curved. And in the end, you see, you get a failure. With the Gyromat, we can identify the refraction, and then, of course, we can reduce it or correct it. For metrology application, I start with an application where you align motion simulators or other devices in a room or in a tunnel, like we have it here, a 3D motion simulator, which have to know the direction of Earth rotation of north. What we do, we use an total station or a theodolite with an autocollimation telescope. We install an autocollimation mirror on the device, here on the motion simulator on this device. We put the Gyromat in a few meter distance to this device and bring the total station into autocollimation, which can be done very precise with these theodolites. And in the end, when it is in autocollimation, we can read out the azimuth. And so we know the direction of this motion simulator. Another metrology application is in shipbuilding. It's on a ship, normally we have a surface network. But the question is how to bring this surface network or the direction into the ship. And for this, we use the Gyromat and measure the surface network direction, and then we can transfer with the Gyromat the direction from the surface to lower decks, for example, to align machineries or whatever needs to know the correct direction or the direction referred to the ship axis. So in the following, I will give you some examples and case studies of tunnel surveys. The first is a water supply tunnel in Ethiopia. This water supply tunnel was built for a 420 megawatt hydropower plant. The length of this tunnel was nearly 26 kilometer. The diameter 7 to 8 meters. This tunnel was driven from two sides with two TBMs, the intake and outlet tunnel. And we did one gyro campaign about 1 kilometer before plant cut through. The intake tunnel was 7.5 kilometer when we did the survey, and the outlet tunnel about 17.5 kilometer. We have to say that on this tunnel construction, we have extreme environmental conditions. We have temperatures up to 42 degrees Celsius and air humidity of 99%. And the result with our gyro campaign was that we get a significant lateral deviation in both tunnels of up to 2.5 meter at the calculated cut-through position. So we had 1 kilometer left to correct this 2.5 meter deviation. And they managed this, and in the end, the lateral deviation of less than 5 centimeters. So without this correction, they would have a lateral deviation of about 1/3 of tunnel width. The second example is a water supply tunnel in Iceland. This is a tunnel tunnel network, which should supply a 690 megawatt hydropower plant. It should supply the water from two reservoirs to this power plant. The total length of the tunnel was 17.2 kilometers. It was done with 3 TBMs from 3 different starting points, and the allowance of horizontal deviation at cut-through points was 20 centimeter, or better than 20 centimeter. And the allowance of deviation from the target direction for every section of 100 meter was better than 15 centimeter. For this service, we had challenging conditions. We had extreme lengths of single tunnel sections. The geometry was very complex. We had a lot of curves and branches, so the sidings had to be very close to the tunnel walls. There were extreme environmental conditions: outside temperature minus 20 degrees and inside up to 40 degrees Celsius. We had high variation of air temperature at tunnel entrance or ventilation holes, air humidity nearly 100%, and also some parts where suddenly water flows into the tunnel with temperature up to 51 degrees centigrade Celsius. So in this tunnel, there were a lot of unavoidable refraction for the traverse lines. Here's some picture. You see outside dealing with the snow for the surface network. Inside, we had a lot of water from above, and also some seas inside. And here is a survey done very close to the tunnel wall. But in the end, we had a faultless operation of Gyromile 3000 with Leica total station TCA 1800 and TS 30. So even in this extreme weather conditions, they worked faultless. And we kept the accuracy. We had 20 centimeter was allowed, as I said, and we achieved about 5 centimeter. The last example which I want to present is a sewer tunnel project in Portland, USA. The length of this tunnel was just 5.5 kilometer with no remarkable inclines or curves. The diameter of about 5 meters, so nothing spectacular. But after a short distance of only 500 meters, they compared two different survey campaigns, one from the contractor and one from the client. And there was a difference of about 25 centimeters for these two campaigns. So the problem or the difficulties in this construction was that its tunneling started from a Hewlett shaft of 50 meter in diameter and 50 meter depth and 18 meter diameter. So the baseline was only 11 meter. That means small plumbing errors causes large lateral errors. And so they asked DMT to do some gyro campaigns, and we did it. We did two gyro campaigns, and in the end, we could find the correct direction, and the breakthrough was done with a few millimeters accuracy. Resume: every tunnel project signifies an investment of several million euro. Tunnel survey take place under difficult environmental conditions. Small errors have a great impact on the technical and economical success of the project. The nightmare of a tunnel driver can be avoided by three steps. First is a guidance system for the TBM, an efficient survey system, and a gyro control survey as an insurance for the right direction. So thank you for your attention, for your thank you.
Yes, thank you, Volker, for your marvelous presentation of the Gyromat 5000 system, history, development, applications in tunneling, mining, and shipbuilding. For me, it was eye-opening. Yeah, as a newbie in this section. And now I want to ask questions from the audience. First of all, from Klaus. Hi, are you developing a new version of the Gyromat? What would be improvements, and when will it be available on the market?
Yes, we make always a further development of the Gyromat technology. In time we must replace the electronic parts of the now running systems, especially in the Gyromat 5000. There are electronic parts which will be no more available in a few years. So there must be a development of a new electronic parts inside of the instrument. But this is a process which is ongoing all the time. And at the moment, we have not a timeline or a special point where we introduce a new system. So we make some further development, which will be one side the electronic parts, and one side make the new instruments more reliable or more comfortable for usage. But presently, we are now in the introduction phase of a new product. It will be take at least some years before a next generation instrument like Gyromat 6000 or however the name will be would introduce in the market.
So may I say something? We are on the end of our maybe in the end of the accuracy with 0.8 milligon, and for this this accuracy range, it's not easy to make further developments. So that's also a reason why we make small steps with our electronic. And another point is that the total stations from Leica, they change frequently, and we adapt our system to this new total station so that we can use new software features from total stations, and like automatic target recognition. So this is included into the new Gyromat, and yeah, these are our steps.
Okay, thank you. Next question from Liz. What is the main obstacle for you to develop Gyromat?
It is, as the forecast said, we have with the accuracy limit of 0.8 milligon, we are dealing on the scratch of the physical possibilities in this range of prices. So it probably would be not possible to make a better instrument in the same price range. So the further development will go more into this way that we make the instrument more reliable, more stable, and more comfortable for usage. So I think the next instrument will be not much accurate, much more accurate than the generation Gyromat 3000, 5000 like now. So it is from technical principle possible, but it will be an instrument with very, very high costs. And I think it is probably not possible to place such an instrument on the market.
Okay, very interesting. Thank you, Jörg. Another question, what kind of total stations or TL lights can be adapted to the Gyromat?
Yes, it is necessary that the Gyromat as the instrument itself will be adapted with a total station, fixed adapted with a total station or a tail light. And we have a good cooperation with Leica. So we use Leica total station and tail lights. For example, From the now running series, we use a TS60 or TS16 total station, which all have an accuracy better than 1 arcsecond. This is the requirement for the total station or for the Teodolite, that the accuracy, the annual accuracy, is better than 1 arcsecond. And for the industrial metrology field, where the autocollimation feature is very interesting for the user, we recommend to use the Hexagon TM6100A, which is a Teodolite, but with included autocollimation feature. And it's very convenient to use this type of Teodolite for applications in metrology and industrial measurements.
Thank you, Jörg. Some additional question came in from Simon. Do you have any experience working in a project in South America?
South America? I know we have project in South Africa. It's a question because of the south part of the hemisphere. So the Gyromat works on the north and also on the south. So we have also in Australia, there are some Gyromats working. And in South America, Gyromat will also work, but I'm not sure if we have sold systems to South America, but I'm not sure. Jörg, do you know if you have some services done from DMT?
Not very much. South America is, I think, one of the continents which have not so much introduced with the Gyromat technology. So far as I know, we have not sold in unit in this region, and also the projects not very much.
Okay, maybe you can get back to Simon Pons after this webinar to with input from Volker or other colleagues.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, another question from Paolo. Optimal gyro baseline length, is 200 meters too much?
No, 200 meters is okay. You must find a compromise between your short, if the baseline is shorter, then the influence of the centering error is higher. And if the baseline is longer, then at some distance, you will get more problems with optical conditions, optical seeing conditions, some refraction effects and such things. But I think for most applications, optimal length is between 100, 200 meter. That is okay. Even 500 meter are possible, or also over kilometer. But then you must pay attention a little bit to the optical seeing conditions.
Okay. Jakob asked, how do magnetic rock formations affect measurement accuracy?
Not very much. The magnetic influence to the instrument is very low. We have an effective shielding system inside, so that even higher magnetic fields do not disturb the gyromat operation.
Okay, I think the question is answered. How long it takes to get the final azimuth result from one point, including setup and preparation?
It is saying in short, it's approximately 1 hour. So when you set up the instrument, it will be take under normal conditions, let's say 10 minutes or 5 minutes, something like that. Then you have to repeat the gyro operation, which takes about 10 minutes each for the Gyromat 3000, or a little bit shorter for the Gyromat 5000 measurements, so that you have, let's say, 45 to 50 minutes. And including the targeting operation with the total station, it is approximately 1 hour for this whole operation at one point.
Okay. What kind of preparations are necessary before I can start a gyromat measurement?
Not very much. You have to pay attention to the temperature adaptation. This means that the inside temperature of the instrument and the outside ambient temperature should be very close, or let's say less than 5 degrees. So you have to wait. If there's a difference, you have to wait that the temperature is within these limits, and then you can start. And one preparation is necessary. You have to know the local latitude, and this must be input in the instrument at the beginning of every gyro operation.
Okay, another question from Simon. Pollution, for instance, dust in the air of the tunnel could affect the measurement of the system?
Yeah, it depends on how many dust. The dust is, of course, not good for the optical seeing. And if you use the total station with RTR function, sometimes the RTR cannot work properly. So it depends on how clear is the air. There is always an influence for this. But normally, in most tunnel environments, even if there are some moisture or fog or something like that, it works. So it depends.
Yeah. So for the gyro mod itself, there's no problem for the dust. It turns to the right direction. But for the targeting with the gyro mod, for the optical, as Jörg said, this is might be a problem. But this is always a problem in the tunnel if you work with the polygon side, traverse lines, and you cannot see clearly, you have problems to see the target.
Okay. Dirk asks, the gyromat and the telelights are obviously from different companies. How do you check if the combined system is working with specification and are calibrated combined and they are calibrated combined or separately?
During the manufacturing progress, we mount the total station or the table light unseparately on the gyromat, and the whole calibration is done with this system, with these two parts, gyromat and total station. So all the effects like temperature errors or alignment errors will be compensated within this calibration procedure. And of course, we need some total station which meets some accuracy requirements. That I said before, that we need an angular accuracy of better than 1 arc second for the total stations. Yeah, and then we make the calibration on the complete system.
Thank you. Jakub asks, are there any types of condition where use of the gyromat would be difficult or impossible?
Yeah, one main error inference is the temperature. If the temperature difference between measurement and environment, ambient temperature is, and the inside temperature of the instrument is too high, let's say it's over 10 degrees or something like that, then you will get probably results which not meet the accuracy. So, inside the instrument, there's a temperature warning system. We have included temperatures inside, and we can look during operation how much is the internal temperature change. And if it overrides a certain value, then you will get the temperature warning, and then probably the results will be not within the specifications. Another important factor is the mechanical impacts, like vibrations or the change of leveling. Also, this error influences will have a negative influence, and we have also a so-called drift warning. This means when the gyro operation is disturbed by, for example, vibrations, and the vibrations are too strong and a certain value will override, then we get a warning, and then probably the results will also not within the specifications. So there are some points you have to pay attention during the measurement operation. One thing is temperature, the other thing is mechanical stability of the setup. And other things are seeing conditions, something like that, refraction effect, something like that. It depends a little bit on the whole environment, how is the situation there. And normally when you can use only the high accuracy total stations, when you say that is environment, when you use, let's say like a TS30 or something as alone, is this good enough, then you can also work with a gyromat. That is, the conditions for both kinds of instruments are similar.
Okay, thank you for your explanations. How many gyromats were sold so far?
The gyromat series started many years ago, nearly 30 years. In 91 of the last century, we started with the production of the gyromat 2000. Then in 2006, we started with the gyromat 3000. And since 2014, we started with gyromat 5000 production and selling. And presently, we have about we have sold about 350 instruments overall, and worldwide, most of the instruments are still in usage. But now we see that the old Gyromat 2000 maybe are at the end of the lifetime. So we try to replace them with Gyromat 5000 instruments.
Do you provide surveying services as well?
Yes, we have an experienced team of surveying engineers which are using the Gyromat in project mostly in tunnel projects worldwide, and depends on the requirements of the user, of the customer, if it is more better to look for the service, or it if more let's say more useful to sell an instrument. So we have both.
Okay, as far as I see, there are no more questions from the audience. So dear participants, dear audience, thank you for listening. It was a pleasure for us, and this is the end of the show. Have a good evening and stay safe.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.